Hi, I'm overshapingfromtwosleepers.com. That's my blog. And I'm going to talk to you today about why I don't pre-brown my vegetables and my meats. And in order to understand that, you have to understand the Maillard reaction, which I will walk you through. So I've been getting a lot of feedback from people going, you know, you're just boiling your meat. I can't understand why you don't saute the vegetables in advance. And of course, you know, there's a reason I'm doing it. So I experiment a lot to come up with a way that's efficient, but that gives you the same benefit. So what you don't want to do is you don't want to use your pressure cooker and cook in the exact same way that you would stovetop, because you're not leveraging quite all of the advantages that pressure cooking offers you. So what I'm going to talk about is what is the Maillard reaction and why you should care, what this means for pressure cooking, and then I'm going to give you some examples of dishes that I've done in that fashion. So here's kind of the technical background on it. So you know, when you brown food, right, like you're browning food on a grill or on a stovetop, what is happening? Well, there's at least two things happening. One is the sugar in that food caramelizes, and that creates a browner appearance. But the other thing, which is a Maillard reaction, is what's happening is the amino acids in that food are creating a web. And that web keeps getting rearranged as the food cooks longer and longer and gets browner. So what is happening in that situation is a web of flavor is being created, and that is what is causing that browning. So that, in a nutshell, is the Maillard reaction. It's different from caramelization, just so we're clear. Caramelization requires only sugar. Maillard requires sugar and protein. So you get a very, very different effect, and the best, of course, is if you can get both the caramelization and the Maillard effect. So in order for the Maillard reaction to take place, there are a couple of criteria that need to be fulfilled. You need a heat above a certain amount. So it needs to be hot. The surface needs to be dry, because what you don't want to do is be evaporating water during that time. And it works better in an alkaline environment. So sometimes, you know how Chinese cooks especially will add baking soda to something. That is to help create that Maillard reaction. So think about a dry, aged steak that has been exposed to the environment, it's been salted, it's been whatever, that thing creates a sear really fast and gets brown really fast and creates a flavor profile really fast. So when a Maillard reaction takes place, it creates sort of this web of flavor, like I mentioned, but each of those molecules sets off another web and another web and another web. So it kind of propagates, and this propagation is what creates layers and layers of flavor. So depending on how long you cook something, it might taste a little bit different. So the other thing to remember is that it is dependent on the content of the food itself. So for example, the browning on bread is very different from the browning on a steak, very different from the browning on, say, asparagus, right? Those flavor profiles are extremely different. So the Maillard reaction is leveraging the basic qualities of the food in order to create that flavor profile. So what the common misconception is that you need to pre-cook and pre-saute food before you put it into a pressure cooker, otherwise it's going to be missing those layers of flavor. And I'm here to tell you that is actually not the case. So think about how a pressure cooker works. What is it doing? It's raising the boiling point of water, because it creates pressure on top, and that pressure means that water can come up to 212 Fahrenheit, 100 degrees centigrade, and still not boiled. So it's superheated water, right? It's a superheated environment, but that's not actually boiling. So when that happens, what's going to happen is those higher temperatures create that browning, the caramelization, the Maillard reaction that needs to take place. So when you just put onions, tomatoes, garlic in for my onion masala, or you just puree the vegetables and throw them in for the korma, you're not actually just boiling that. The heat is creating that layers and layers and layers of flavor. So instead of standing there and stirring everything, you should just let the pressure cooker do its job. You should let the pressure cooker just dump everything in, cook it, and that heat from inside is going to raise the temperature, is going to create the Maillard reaction. Now, if you would like to, and I often do this, if you would like to, after the fact, you can pre-brown, because there's another level of Maillard that occurs at, like, say, 250 Fahrenheit. So what you could do is you could cook your food, you could let all of the hard work be done, and at that point, you can turn it back on if you want to, and you can saute the sauce if you want. Now, take out the meat, take out the whatever you had in there so it doesn't overcook, but if you want to re-caramelize the sauce, do it afterwards. There's an important reason why. One, it's less work if you let the pressure cook the work. But see, here's what happens. When you pre-saute the vegetables, especially water-giving vegetables like onions, tomatoes, peppers, you're essentially evaporating the water that's in there. Okay, so you've taken this vegetable that had water that was going to help you cook, and you've decided to take it out. So you've sauteed it, you've evaporated the water out, And then, because pressure cooking needs water, you're putting mac in water. You're putting mac in plain water when you could have used the flavored water. So you're kind of working against yourself. A, you're creating more work. B, you're reducing flavor and adding plain water to compensate. So don't do that. Just put the vegetables in, let the pressure cooker create the Maillard reaction with the meat or whatever you're putting in. And then if you want to afterwards, you can brown. But keep in mind also that if you evaporate the vegetables, you're gonna have to add water and you really don't wanna do that. So this is the main reason why I actually don't pre-saute my meats and vegetables. I just feel like you're working against what the pressure cooker can truly give you. So don't think of it as just something that actually cooks the food. Think of it as a flavor creator. I'm gonna do another episode on why a pressure cooker gives you a very different flavor from what a slow cooker would. But I want you to, if you have time or the interest, go on to twosleepers.com and look at these four recipes. That onion masala, you ask any person who's grown up in an Indian household. We spend hours of our lives creating that masala. And what it is you have to caramelize aromatics like onion, ginger, and garlic, and then we put tomatoes on, and you stir, and you stir, and you stir. Your hair smells of it. I'm not even exaggerating. Your pores smell of this thing, but it gets a beautiful flavor. Or you could put everything in the pressure cooker following that recipe, and you could cook it for 10 or 15 minutes, and that Maillard reaction happens, and then you can saute after that to further increase the caramelization. Same thing happens with the chicken korma. You know, it's unheard of in Indian cooking to just dump everything in and not even pre-saute it. But again, you're not leveraging the pressure cooker for what it can do for you if you sit there and brown. The Ethiopian dorawat recipe, same thing. Making that onion mixture could take you all day, or you could do it in a pressure cooker. And then I have this rice ghee recipe. So you know, if you've been to Indian restaurants, they serve you that dessert with a little bit of, it looks like rice pudding, except it's more liquid. That dessert should not look white. So when it looks white, it's, in my view anyway, it's not done properly. What it should be is this rich caramel flavor, this thick sauce that just bathes your tongue in it. And that's how it should really taste. If you follow the recipe on the blog, it asks you to leave the rice be after it's done cooking. And the reason for that is that's when the whole mixture is getting caramelized. So in many, many instances, when you are pre-sauteing it, you're working against yourself. Don't do that. Let it do it afterwards. And look for recipes where you can cut those steps out now that you understand what the Maillard reaction is. So that is my very quick overview on why I don't pre-brown meats and vegetables. And I'm Irvashi from twosleepers.com, and I hope this was helpful. Thank you.